In the graphic novel Watchmen, Dr. Manhattan has the ability to disassemble and reassemble molecules at will. It's the ability of a god, and not something a human being could ever do. Or is it? I'm Rusty Ward, and I was really disappointed when I hit puberty and didn't develop mutant powers. I wanted to fly, shoot lasers from my eyes, and swing a girder around like it was a wiffle ball bat. Instead, all I got was really bad acne. I drowned my sorrows in a countless number of comic books. There I saw Firestorm convert earth into water, and the Silver Surfer turn metal into glass. They were capable of manipulating the atomic structure of objects. Of all the superpowers, this one always seemed the most powerful, the most jaw-dropping and mind-blowing. It's also one that's within our reach. In 1959, Richard Feynman gave a lecture titled "There's Plenty of Room at the Bottom" and introduced to the world the concept of working on things at an atomic level. In 1986, K. Eric Drexler wrote the book Engines of Creation and popularized this idea along with the term nanotechnology. A nanometer is a unit of measurement used to measure things on an atomic scale. To give you an idea of how small a nanometer is, a single sheet of newspaper is 100,000 nanometers thick. And on a comparative scale, if the diameter of a marble was 1 nanometer, the diameter of the Earth would be 1 meter. Drexler proposed building machines called molecular assemblers. These are machines that could pull an atom off of one molecule and then attach it to another, thereby creating an entirely new molecule. Up until this time, this was theoretical. We didn't have the ability to precisely manipulate single atoms, let alone to organize them on a large scale. Then, in 1986, the same year that Drexler's book came out, the atomic force microscope was invented. This enabled us to not only see atoms, but to individually touch them. In 1989, IBM used this technology to spell out their logo in atoms. 10 years later, Cornell University understood the chemical bondings of atoms well enough to create their own molecule. In 2009, we started to see the first nanoscale robotic assembly devices, the most advanced of which was introduced this year by David Lee at the University of Manchester. It works like an assembly line. It involves an arm moving along a molecular track and picking up building blocks along the way. At the end of the track, a new molecule is created. These are the first steps towards large-scale manufacturing of man-made molecules, and the potential benefits of this science are difficult to overestimate. We could solve global warming by breaking down the excess carbon dioxide in our atmosphere. We could end world hunger by turning deserts into farmlands. And farms may even become obsolete as Star Trek-like replicators become commonplace devices. And replicators will become commonplace, because one of the incredible aspects of these machines is that they're self-replicating. One molecular machine can make the next, reducing manufacturing costs to next to nothing, and making this technology affordable to everyone. As an individual wielding a microscopic army of nanomachines, you could make solid objects evaporate, or even rewrite your own DNA. But we'll talk about that more in the future episode of Science Friction that takes on shape-shifting. Many scientists believe we'll have this ability within a century. Eric Drexler believes something different. He thinks we'll master molecular reconfiguration 10 years before the seas rise and drown the human race. What he's implying is that we're very close. We simply need the will to achieve this goal. Unfortunately, we often need an impending disaster like global warming to push us over the finish line. I want to welcome all my new subscribers that came over from Vsauce after my friend Michael linked to the last episode. If this is your first episode, be sure to subscribe and let me know what superpower you want.